Jesus. Praise the Lord for the Spirit of God moving, for His love, for His kindness, for His joy. Amen. I'm going to pray over you guys real quick. You guys just bow your heads. Dear Lord, I ask, Lord Jesus, that you work on the soil of their hearts right now, Lord Jesus, that they can receive this word, Lord. I pray in the name of Jesus that you break every stony heart, Lord Jesus. And like Ezekiel 36 says, that you bring a heart of flesh, Lord. That you soften them, Lord Jesus, to really hear your word, to understand that they are not accidents, Lord, that they were born with purpose, Lord, that you called them, Lord Jesus, before they were even created, before you created them in their mother's womb. Lord Jesus, I pray that they get to know you, Lord. They get to know the true living God. They must know you, Lord. And I just ask right now, Lord Jesus, that this word, Lord Jesus, permeate their hearts, build them up, Lord Jesus, that they can live for you, Lord, that they can bear fruit, Lord, for your kingdom. Lord, center them in the middle of your will, Lord, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Praise God. Okay. So, you know, some messages are just kind of like, you know, they're all beautiful, but there's so many times I've shared with you guys, I'll be reading the word and I'll be like, ooh, that's an awesome revelation. Ooh, that's an amazing thing to teach or preach later. And then the Lord would say, yes, it's my word. It's my word. It is awesome. And I'll be like, Lord, can I preach to the people? And he'd be like, nope, that was for you. That's not for them now. And then when he tells me something, and then I go, ooh, I was like, you want me to say that, Lord? And the Lord's like, I look back, and it's like crickets. It's like literally when Jesus said, if it possible, can you remove this cup from me? Is there another option? Jesus was praying to the Father saying, is there another option? His flesh was coming into play at that point. He was doing the will of the Father, but his flesh was coming in and saying, if there's another way to do this, let's do that. If I don't have to die on the cross, if I don't have to feel any suffering and all humanity can actually be saved, if I don't have to take their punishment and I can do something different so that they still be saved, can we do that? And what do you think Jesus heard? Absolute silence. And to think about the things that God is requiring us to do is going to be beyond our will, y'all. It's going to have to do with us understanding that God's will always come first. Amen? Amen. And that is the truth. And the truth shall make us free. So the Spirit of the living God was speaking to me about something. Specifically, Jesus was checking some of the Pharisees. And I'll give you a little context to paint. And I got you to turn the music down just a taste. Jesus was talking to the Pharisees. And they were all arguing about things. They always like to argue. And at least the Pharisees. In his days when he was walking on the earth. And he spoke to them about what really corrupted an individual. What really messes us up? Because they were always arguing about right and wrong, morality, you know, basically seeing whose righteousness is better than the other. And it came to a point where they complained about what they were going to eat. They got on the disciples for not washing their hands. I remember so many years, we see them little, the one thing at Costco you can go through is a bunch of fruit snacks, amen? Costco got like 100 different snacks. They literally do that on purpose, right when you get up to the front. And you see all them snacks. And I remember grabbing a few and you eat something so good, and then that last one you're about to eat and then it drop on the ground. And then you ain't looking at nobody. Are you going to eat that? Now me, you know, the people be like, God made dirt. Dirt don't hurt. right? I was very like germaphobe. I'm like, ooh, no, I ain't even touching it. It's gone, right? 5 second rule, 15 second rule, 5 minute rule. What do you mean? But they were bugging because they were like, hey, wash your hands. That's what corrupts you. And he was like, it's not what you eat, y'all. It's not what you eat that actually corrupts you. He said, it's what comes out of your mouth. It's what you say. That messes you up. He says, a tree, everybody say a tree. Is identified by its fruit. If a tree is good, its fruit will be good. If a tree is bad, its fruit will be bad. Jesus says, you brood of snakes. He says, how could evil men like you speak what is good and right? For whatever is in your heart, everybody say heart, determines what you say. Whatever's going on inside of here, or excuse me, if I hear something from your lips, I know what's going on in your heart. If you say some craziness out of your mouth, craziness in your heart. You speaking evil out of your mouth, evil in your heart. Y'all like, ooh, that's harsh. It's the truth. Jesus was making it very clear and simple. We got a lot of people acting like, I'm a good person. No, you ain't. No, you ain't. What's your conversation like? What's your conversation like, really? How do you be talking? How do you be talking to each other? Or talking about each other? So the Spirit of the Living God spoke to me. Jesus continues to say, a good person produces, everybody say produces, good things from the treasury of a good heart. And an evil person produces evil things from the treasury of an evil heart. He says, and I tell you this, Jesus puts a stance on, you must give account on what? Judgment day. Well, there's a judgment? Yes, there is a judgment, y'all. Every single soul has to face the living God. Every soul, alive, meaning born again, dead, meaning unborn, you spiritually dead, you rejected God, you're still going to have to see Christ. And he will judge you. And he says, every person will give account. Meaning, and you're going to have to go through everything. I don't know if you a little baby, Google Gaga, all the way up to you a gramps if you make it like that. All right? For every idle word, everybody say idle word. Every idle word you speak. It said the words you say will either acquit you or condemn you. Anybody think Jesus is a liar here? Okay. Everybody like, oh, you set me up. Yeah, go say it, because you're going to have to talk to him later, according to this scripture. Regardless. Jesus is saying, watch what you say. Understand what should be in the treasury of your heart. Because that, my friend, is what's really messing you up. And for the people of God that are the people of faith, we know better, or at least we should know better. Do we know better? Let's look what the scriptures say about our words. Speak the truth in love. It says, fools' words get them into constant fights or quarrels. They are asking, I'm going to paraphrase it, for a beatdown. Help me, Lord. Reminds me of high school fights. When you hear that one chapping, like, blah, 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 I'm going to do this, blah, blah, blah. And it'd be the dude super quiet. And I'd be like, oh, that's the dude. This is the guy that's quiet. That's the one that's about to mollywop him. I'm telling you. Be the loud one, be like, rah, rah, rah. And the quiet one just looking like, one more word. one more word. I'm telling you. And then they just get up and just walk over. Boom! Person laid out on the ground. What you say can get you into a heap of mess. Amen? Amen? Amen. I'm speaking to somebody because the Holy Ghost don't give me this type of message unless something's going on. All right? So we got to be a little careful how we're speaking. Okay? Now, this is the Proverbs. This is from Solomon, who was the wisest man. Why was he wise? Because instead of asking for riches, instead of asking for all the things to inherit this world, he said, Lord, give me the wisdom that comes from you. The wisdom to work in and out of people. Right? And God gave him so much more. It says, the mouths of fools are their ruin. They trap, everybody say trap, themselves with their lips. Oh, man. Saints of God, people listening, you need to watch what you're saying and how you're saying it. Amen? Sometimes we got a way of saying things, amen? We can have, it could be the truth, but we could be very reckless in how we say it. Amen? And put all the little extra in between. It wasn't even needed. Amen. Like the seasoning. Like, you didn't need that much salt. What you doing? Help me, Lord. You could trap yourself, y'all. You could really trap yourself. I ain't even got to put the examples. I already know the Holy Ghost is letting you remind yourself. Like, oh, man, what was that? Woo! Help me, Jesus. But remember, every problem, there's always a solution. Amen? Give you a little hope there. Amen? It said rumors. Everybody say rumors. Another word for that is gossips. Oh, now we getting warm here. Gossips are dainty morsels that sink deep into one's heart. Some of y'all like to eat up that gossip. Eat up that talk. What's going on with social media? What's trending? What's that? Did you know so-and-so was this? Did you know da-da-da-da-da? Did you know that was happening? So-and-so at the job does this. Oh, man. And it'd be like the bulk of your conversation. Do you guys understand if you're a saint of the living God, if you are really born again, you are called to a higher standard. You're called to not even operate in any form of slander, any form of accusation, any form of rumors or gossips. For some people, it's like a meal. They cannot stop doing this. It's almost like they're feeding themselves. It's almost like I had a friend of mine, and he talked a little crazy, but he definitely had a spirit of violence because somebody could look at him wrong and he was ready to just hop out of the car. He's like, what you looking at? I was just like, man, what you doing? I was like, we at the red light. Like, I'm trying to go. Like, we going to hop out of the car and hit this dude? I was all locking the door, like, I'm locking. You ain't get out, I got to put child lock for him. Sit in the back, man. Put child lock for Michael. Boy, it was bugging. He was ready to roll, but I was like, man, something was different. He was almost like a loose pit. I don't know if a blue nose, red nose, but he was hot, all right? And he had to feed off of that. He was like, if I don't beat somebody down, if I don't do something, I feel weird. And that's the thing. Some people, some of y'all was practicing a lot of behavior. Some of y'all was talking. If y'all don't get in that gossip, it's like you feel like something's missing in your life. God is saying, don't have poisonous lips. Amen. That's why he called the Pharisees a brood of snakes. Snakes have what? Poison, amen? They have venom. You can just talk to a snake, be like, hey, how you doing, snake? And you rub the top of the head, be like, oh, you okay? Try that with a venomous snake, for real. I don't care how long you've been. Still, the people that train, when they train, they know at any given moment that thing can strike. Amen? Any given moment. So we need to understand the seriousness of what we say. He said, a lazy person is bad as someone who destroys things. Wow. It's not even getting into procrastination, amen? Help me, Jesus. Some of y'all have been, I'll do this next week. I'll do this next month. You still got that going on? Yeah, I think I'm going to do it next year. Help me, Lord. Said wise words. Everybody say wise words. Satisfy like a good meal. Wisdom really satisfies. When you are speaking truth to people, you're actually bringing life to them. When you're speaking in faith, not doubt, you're actually doing something for the soul of that person. The Bible says that cruel words crush the spirit, amen? But it says kind words bring marrow to the bones, all right? It said the right words bring satisfaction. The tongue, everybody say the tongue, can bring death or life. That is how powerful your conversation is. How you speak really does matter. You can bring death to others. Some people are like, well, they may have been in physically abusive relationships or come up in a household where it wasn't necessarily physical abuse, but there was verbal abuse. And do you understand that abuse is abuse, right? That your mind, your heart, your senses can't tell the difference. When someone is killing you with their words. And then we wonder why we speak the way that we speak. Because we haven't had that part of us renewed. We haven't had that part of us fully surrendered. It said, those who love to talk will reap the consequences. What it means by that is those that do not put a safeguard around their mouths, around what they say and how they say it, amen? You're going to deal with some type of consequences in this. And now you ask pastor, you say, well, why do I talk the way that I talk? Well, let's start with the first problem. Something is going on in your mind and your heart. The seat of your emotions. Something is a little off. You have something where you're focusing too much on other things. Remember, before you say something, before you act upon it, what happens? Thoughts occur. That's why Christ told us that we have to capture every imagination, every thought to the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. Meaning, before even that thought comes, amen, as crazy as it may be, give it to the Lord Jesus first. And say, Jesus, what do you want me to do with this? I'm serious. Y'all think I'm schizophrenic. I'm being real. You understand? I'm saying the moment something comes in your mind, you're saying, Lord, what do you think about this? Before it comes out of your mouth. Before you act upon it. Amen? We have something happening. We ready to go. For real. And you don't think the enemy knows y'all buttons? You don't be keeping watch. He like that. Taking notes. Okay, I'm going to use mama today. You know what? I'm going to use the brother. Actually, let's use the teacher. You know what? I'm going to use their boss. And he'd be like, why? What? I'm telling you guys how this works. To keep you in this perpetual state. This perpetual state of sin, this perpetual state of unforgiveness and bitterness. Why? Because daily life, we deal with offense. Amen? Someone's going to offend you. Someone's going to say something that ain't right, that don't feel right, and then it's how you handle it. Amen? Like I said, you can control how you respond to things, not what happens around you. And one of the things that happens most of the time has to do with this, our mouth. Amen? Oh, yeah, it's real quiet here. Is it those who control, everybody say control. Control. Their tongue will have a long life. Look at some benefits there. Amen? It says opening your mouth can ruin everything. Now, this is what I love about James, the brother of Jesus. He starts speaking to the churches, and he's saying to the brothers and sisters. I love how he starts off, my dear brothers and sisters. Because oftentimes, we talk to each other and forget that we're actually family. And I know that's weird for the world, because they're like, nah, you ain't blood like that. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to tell you right now, when you get spiritually reborn, God gives you a new language. It's just like a kingdom, right? Look, most of us in here, okay, how do you know what country was influenced or dominated by the kingdom of Spain? By what? The language they speak. Amen? You go to where? Dominican Republic. You go over here. You go over there. And what happens? There's people look like me. And I talk to them. They'd be like, what you saying? That's why I met a buddy of mine who's from Panama. And I was like, he looked like my dad. But he couldn't speak English like that. And I was just like, oh, what's going on? But when you know the heavenly kingdom is upon you, you got a heavenly language. Amen. And so God gives us access to something. And he says, you are more than just what you see. You guys are family, spiritual family. That's why he starts off, brothers and sisters. You think every single person in there was literally from the same dad and the same mom? That's like the old school churches, right? They just had that one family and they just keep multiplying, five generations. Be like, we all related. What? Nah. No, we're related in the spirit. Because God is our Father, amen? And he gives us the Holy Spirit. And he tells us to be literally born again. Amen? Are you catching it? From below? No, from above. So now we become citizens of heaven, family of heaven. That's all we're telling folks. You become citizens of heaven. So if you are a citizen of heaven, why are you talking to each other like that? Why are you addressing each other as something else? He says, you must, means non-optional. Be quick to listen. See if everybody's listening. Quick to listen, not slow to listen, amen? When y'all on some, I ain't trying to hear nobody, yeah. Or trying to look at something. Trying to turn the music up, trying to turn TV up. That's what my dad would do when we'd be talking. He'd be like, hold on, guys, hold on. He started turning the TV up. I'm like, Dad. He'd be like, help me, Jesus. Slow to speak, slow to get. Everybody say angry. Angry. Oh, look at the results, y'all. Tell me that doesn't happen. Half the time, people going back and forth. Blah, 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 blah. Do y'all really... be honest. How much of the conversation did you capture when you yell at each other? All you hear is, ah, and then maybe one word. You did, oh, what? Mama? Who? Oh, hold on. Let me take off my shoes. Let's go. Quick to listen. Meaning in, and I've shared this before, because we used to do this in sales, and it helped me. And I remember reading this, and he said, God gave you two ears, amen, one mouth. Twice the listening, less talking. Amen? We got one ear. You're like, huh? How are you? What you say? That's the truth. We got to do a lot more listening, amen? When you listen, you're caring for the person, whether you know it or not. Dialogue, amen, is back and forth. Monologue is you doing, you know, some Shakespeare, you know, and everybody watching you. Dialogue is back and forth. I hear, you speak, I hear. Amen? We take in the information. But what happens is that don't happen. Then everybody get angry, quick. Then fights come. Then we get warned. God is saying it's got to stop. It's got to stop. It's got to get to a point where we really look at, we look for each other, amen, as the family of God. He said, do not listen to an accusation. Wait a second. Preacher, why you bring up this scripture? Because this is the one that really be getting people. And everybody be thinking that this is like a, this should be a norm in the church. You better be careful how you speak. Now I'm speaking in the Holy Ghost now, telling everybody. Some of y'all don't know the scriptures like that. Most of y'all really don't. Just flat out. When Paul was speaking, the Apostle Paul was speaking to Timothy, the elder, the leader, the bishop over there, he was telling them how church order should be, how we should function as the family of God. But he said that if anybody brings up any form of slander or accusation against an actual elder, an actual pastor, an actual leader that's overseeing the congregation, he said it has to be confirmed by two or three witnesses. Meaning, and don't even take it into account. That's how much he trusted the order of God. This wasn't his orders. These were instructions from the Lord Jesus Christ. But I'm going to tell you right now, you can look at YouTube, you can look at Facebook, type in, and you see a whole bunch of slander going against pastors. And what has happened now is because a few bad eggs are out there, now you consider all of them bad eggs. Now you got an overly critical eye and thinking someone's going to dupe you. When you have to be careful, you got to watch the word of God. Because remember, every word that you said, y'all talk bad, hey. I would say, I would be like, repent. I would go to the Lord and say, I repent. I've shared this plenty of times. I've prayed for all of you, every single person in this place, future congregation, so forth. It comes with the territory. But what I will say is that if you have talked bad about your brothers here, about the ministry, about even me, I'm telling you right now, you need to repent. You need to go to God and say, Lord, forgive me. I'm sorry. I was bugging. Just on strength of that, just on the strength of the word of God. If you really believe it like that, regardless, you're going to be held accountable. So when you get warning, it's a good thing to listen. It got so bad in some cases. Nowadays, everybody's, this is the year of exposure. It's exposure. How about y'all check y'all mouths? How about we be a little careful about what we say first and not just believe, like I said before, everything you see posted on social media or especially secular media. Secular media, and what I mean by that is just regular news. You think the regular news really care about Jesus like that? You think the regular news really care about you like that? They don't care about you. They're here to manipulate you because the God of this world is over that. You got to stay in this word and the truth of this word. You got to know that the Holy Spirit is the truth. Amen? I don't need a newspaper. I got the Holy Ghost. Amen? I got spiritual discernment in the Spirit. The Bible says that once you receive the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of promise, you receive power, dunamis, explosive power. And this power holds the truth. He said the Spirit of God will lead and guide you into all truth, meaning and when falsehood comes, you'll know it. That's why we tell people, get born again, get filled with the Holy Ghost. so you can navigate this world. And stop letting the world play puppet with your mind. And you think you're doing something right, and you really ain't living right for God. That's who really exposes, amen? It says whatever's done in the dark comes to light. And what God is saying is that His Word, the Holy Spirit, sheds light on things. Be careful what you say, especially to people of God. Don't talk about men and women of God. Don't talk about pastor and leaders like that. I'm just going to tell you in the Spirit. I'm done with the slander. Hear me in the Holy Ghost. The problem is you don't have a healthy fear of God. You think that people just hear by accident. We just like chose ourselves. Do you understand? I knew when God was going to kill my life, when I was going to die the first time. I had arrogance like a stench. And I was driving up the grapevine. Some of y'all know the grapevine. And it was raining just like this. And I was headed up back to my home in Bakersfield. Coming up from LA, boom, headed over. And I was like, oh, it's cool. It just stopped. And then all of a sudden, whoo, a bunch of hell snow. Hell and snow and all this, and just slush on the ground. And it was like bumper cars. Y'all did bumper cars in other places? Y'all be like, yeah, the theme park. No, it looked like that on the 5 going up. And I thought I was cool because I had my little Mazda. I was like, oh, I got a little sport. I'm okay. And then literally somebody's like half truck Chevy or something went like this. And then just, I kid you not, I saw the back of their thing lost control and it was about a foot away from hitting me. And I turned and I said, oh, I'm okay. And as I was turning, I was like, whoa, wait a second. I said, hold on. I'm like 360 in this thing. About 5 times. Because I thought I was just going to do one of these and be like, I avoided it. What you don't know is I was on a conversation with my bishop at the time. And I was a little young whippersnapper. And I was talking stuff. And he's an authority, higher authority than me, in the Spirit. And I start talking to him. And there was arrogance. I didn't know I had a blind spot. It was arrogance. It was pride. It was ego. And I was saying some stuff to him. And I knew it was a stench to God's nostrils, to the point where, as I was turning, I was just like, nah, 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 nah. And then I was like, oh, and then the phone went off my hand. I had him on speaker, just flew out. And then I'm like, oh. Thank God there were no cameras up there. I bet the angels of heaven like laughing, like, ah, help me. They got it all recorded. They were like, yeah, we remember that time. I was like, you was bugging. Literally, I was turning like this. I thought I had it all together. I was swinging all out of control. And then I ended up being horizontal, just like this, in the middle of the freeway, while all these tractor trailers are coming. And they ain't slowing down, y'all. They gonna slow down for me with all the slush on the ground. If they slow down, it's about to be even worse. And now you got 20-some cars in front, just all discombobulated. So they're trying to slow down as fast as possible. But I'm like, I look up, and you know, I think in those moments, you're like, you know, like a movie, like, I would do this. Y'all watch movies, be like, I would do this instead. Ain't none of that happen. I would, man, come on, I get out of the car, flip, dip, boom. Nope, that's not what happened. I'm panicked. I was like, look, what? And then, like, you know what I heard the Lord say? When I dropped my phone on the ground, I looked, I said, Lord, I get it. I said, I get it. Like, I'm tripping. I am messed up. And then he said, I didn't give you a spirit of fear. Get those keys, turn it. I turned it, it went on. That was a miracle because usually everything shut down. You see me? Turn it on. I started it, I kid you not, maybe 30 seconds before everybody came, literally. I don't know. It was just perfect timing. Nothing but the Lord. I started the car, I just drove, and thank God I had it not this way towards the other side of the traffic, but I actually had it towards the exit, and there was an exit right there, and I just went like this. A little 5-10 miles, and just went away. And then all these people were just passing me. And I went off the exit, And I stayed up in that snow. And I said, Lord, I guess I'm camping out in these mountains tonight. And the Lord said, I didn't give you a spirit of fear. Start the car, get back on, and go to your family. I said, all right. I got back on. Went behind that truck. Because, you know, I had to drive like Miss Daisy. Amen. I had to drive slow. I was like, I'm not going back. We were all driving 70, 75. So I went behind this big tractor trailer, and the snow was just going. And I was literally perfectly, my wheels were right on the flat surface. It wasn't touching nothing. I was just like this, just looking around. He probably like, what is this person? It's like a fly attached to like some elephant. I was just like literally behind. Like any moment, I was just like, I don't care. I was just like, I don't care if I get stuck to you, you know? So I followed him all the way back down that grapevine, got to my home, got safely. Everybody was panicking. It was like, Elder Jones, almost got an accident. What happened? Da, da, da. Right? Now, only me and Bishop at the time knew what really happened. Everybody was all feeling bad for me, and I was just like, yeah, I was tripping. See, this is one thing that you guys are going to know. I feel the Holy Ghost here. When I held onto that steering wheel, y'all, I thought I had my life. I thought I had my life in my own hands. I thought I was the one making the decisions. I thought I can just maneuver life the way I wanted to move them. But the Lord showed me something very quickly. I was never in control. I was never in control. He told me, what you can control is your character. You can control what you say and how you respond to things. But I had to humble you because your arrogance, he said, I have to fulfill my word. He said, I give grace to the humble, but I resist the proud. I resist the ones that think they know it all. He said, how can I help you out if you're going against my word? His word says that before destruction, pride is there. So the one thing I can share with the saints of God here, don't let pride be the motivating factor on why you can't check your mouth, why you can't check your actions, why you can't correct your behavior. Because regardless, no matter how much you want to act like it's not true, what you say, what you do, it really does matter, and it will bring consequences. And in some cases, you'd be right on the door of dying. So I don't play with God no more. Let's move on. He said, therefore, whenever we have an opportunity, everybody say opportunity.
Opportunity.
We should do good to who? Some people?
Everyone.
I only just treat people the way I want to be treated. So if they don't treat me right, then I ain't going to treat them right. Nah, it's not how it works. It's not how it works. Y'all understand? I've seen people, I'm telling you, they have loved on people that have killed their own brothers. Like they're friends with the dude that shot and killed their own brother. That's hard. Y'all think that's easy? And they came to the Lord and they love Jesus now. And they was young. They was like in the 20s. You know what I mean? I think 20 or 18 or something like that. Oh, people that, like, I'm telling you, they families. They gunning people down. And one of the brothers ended up becoming an elder. Ended up God washing them clean. And then they saw his example and he was able to reach the rest of the people. Because they knew his life. They knew he was running the streets. It was just like, oh, that's a different dude. See, God will scoop up whoever he wants to scoop up. Don't ever think whatever background you come, that's nonsense. Come on, y'all. Paul, do you understand Paul was a shot caller? Oh, y'all don't want to hear me. When it comes to the Pharisees, he was like, yeah, go and kill them Christians. We good. He even dropped his cloak and said, yes, approved. So much that Jesus had to confront him and say, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? He's like, why are you persecuting you? He said, you persecuted me because when you hurt these people. And this is the Holy Spirit's telling me to tell you guys. When y'all fight each other, you are really hurting Christ's body. If we are the body of Christ, when we give each other attitude, when we snap at each other, talking behind each other's back, slandering, there's a way that we're supposed to operate. And it says we are supposed to make the effort, especially to who? Everybody say the family of faith. God is saying y'all need to be treating each other right and cut all this. Well, it ain't really my thing. Da, da, da. Somebody say something wrong and all of a sudden they just like out of this world to us. They don't even exist anymore. Here's the reason why. He said, brothers and sisters, fix your thoughts. Everybody say thoughts. What you say is how you're thinking. Amen? 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 It says, what is true, honorable, right and pure, lovely and admirable. This needs to be on your mind. Say, Lord, get my mind right. Say, Lord, get my heart right. When you get those things synced up with his word, you're going to start acting right. You're going to start speaking right. He said, think about the things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Let's be real. How many things that go through your mind, is it really that excellent? It's just like, oh, this is some excellent stuff we thinking right here. It's probably just some basic, like, man, did I leave my toothbrush on the charger? Like, man, I think I got the Amazon package I'm waiting for. Like, how much gas we got in the car? That's the we thinking about. I got to pay that bill tomorrow. Lord, like, you really want to be consumed with that? Because that's what it is. Oh, yeah, it's like, I can't wait. Can't wait till he's done. We got, what, 30 more minutes? Ooh, I'm thinking about, let's go to Red Lobster. Where are we going? Are we going to eat afterwards? Can't wait. I can't wait. Some of y'all are fasting, so hey. Relax. Amen. It said, keep putting into, everybody say, practice. Practice. You got to do it. Amen. Keep putting into practice. They were already doing it. He's saying, continue to do it. Practice what you're learning. What you receive from me. Who's me? The apostle. The leader, the pastor. He said, what you hearing, continue to walk in this. He said, what you heard, what you saw me doing, not just what you hear, but look at do you guys understand? A true pastor, a true elder is supposed to be an example to the flock. I ain't just saying it and not doing it. I'm doing it. You understand? That's how it is. I'm temporarily here up until Jesus comes back. And we all are servants. Amen? They got to deal with him. He says, then the God of peace will be with you. All right, let's wrap it up on Ephesians 4. I would highly suggest you guys, on your own time, go into Ephesians 4 and really, really meditate on this word. All right? He says, instead we will speak the truth. Everybody say truth. In love, not in hate. Growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of his body, the church. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly as each part does its own special work. It helps the other parts grow. When you do what you're supposed to do in speaking the truth in love, you are now operating in a special work. As you operate in these special works, the Bible says that you're helping in the development, the growth of each other. This is why it's so hard for the body of Christ. The enemy knows if I can keep them divided, then guess what? The house won't stand. He said every kingdom that's divided will not stand. Amen? So if he keeps, there's a form of division going on, then how do you grow? You can't. How do you get strengthened? You can't. Because everybody has their special work to do. Amen? Everybody is valuable in the body of Christ. Amen? Period. Don't believe in any lie that you're not. I wouldn't even be preaching the way that I preach. You understand? I'm not going to make any assumptions that I'll be here tomorrow. I'm going to tell you the truth right now while I have the opportunity. Because to be honest with you, God is done with the sugar-coated messages, amen? The motivational speeches. That ain't me. The Spirit of God is trying to get you guys to wake up, recognize your whole body, recognize your family. That you need to grow healthy and you need to be growing full of love, amen? He says, with the Lord's authority, I say this, live no longer like the Gentiles do. What he means by that is don't be living like the world. You let the world be your standard and not the word of God. He said, for they are hopelessly confused. Why are they so hopelessly confused? Because their minds, everybody say minds, are full of darkness. They ain't thinking about nothing else. All it takes me two moments. I don't even have TikTok, y'all. But I'm going to tell you, if I probably looked at TikTok, it's probably a bunch of nonsense, right? Just goofiness beyond goofiness. People sliding all day. Be like a mindless drone. Go on the reels. And then you're watching giraffes like play the piano or something. It's just like, what's going on? Where did you go? And they'd be like, oh, then 4 hours and passed by. That is strategic, y'all. Satan knows how to capture the minds of people. All of that, sensory output, all that stuff is strategic. He said they wander far from life of God because they have closed their minds and hardened their hearts against him. He said they have no sense of shame and they live for lustful pleasure and eagerly practice every kind of impurity. He said, but that isn't what you learned about Christ, since you have heard about Jesus and have learned the truth that comes from him. It says, so stop telling, everybody say lies. Stop telling lies. Let us tell our neighbors the truth, for we are all parts of the same body. And don't let sin do what? It said, don't sin by letting anger control you. Okay. It says, don't let the sun go down while you're still angry. Folks, when y'all get angry, settle it with the Lord quickly. Amen. I'm going to tell you, this is the danger in it. It says, for anger, everybody says anger, gives a foothold, a space. You give territory for the devil. The moment you let anger and bitterness reside, you're saying, enemy, build up your real estate. Do what you want here. It said, if you are a thief, quit stealing. Instead, use your hands for good and hard work. And then give generously to others in need. It said, don't use, foul or abusive language. All right, who got potty mouth here? Everybody like, ooh, we'll see. Stub your toe. Somebody snatched something from you. Somebody cut you off. We'll see what your mouth looking like. Get you real upset. He said, don't use it. Don't let that be your arsenal anymore. He said, let everything you say be good and helpful, which means everything you speak should be grace to those that are hearing it. It should build them up. But because we're full of anger, because we're full of spite, we're full of strife inside of us, and we get that, we consume it, to the point where we're literally operating on so much defensive. Anything offends us, boom, we're ready to tear them apart with our words and our actions. But the difference between the Christian or the believer is that we should actually be mindful of what we say and try to build up those that are there. We should be so mindful, say, Lord, how can I build this other person up instead of tear them down? It says, so that your words be encouragement to those who do what? Hear them. And do not bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Here's what's happening. Those of you guys that are filled with the Holy Ghost, I'm going to tell you right now. The way you get the Holy Spirit jealous, And not even just jealous, weeping. And I'll tell you how personal it gets, y'all. It's like you're being faithful to someone and then they cheat on you. That's how the Holy Spirit looks at it. It's like, you're cheating on me. Sorrow, that word for sorrow in the Greek is like literally someone being literally betrayed. We cannot let our lives start portraying a life of disappointment to the Holy Spirit. He said, remember, God has identified you as his own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Now everybody say, get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words. And look at that word, slander. Wait a second. You're telling me accusing and using slander is actually on the same level as rage and anger? Oh man, people of God, I got something to say. See, one of the hard things, another man of God shared this and I thought it was awesome. It was a pastor out in Chicago. But he said something about church folk. And he said, church folk, we like to marginalize our sin. We like to be like, you the worst of the worst, because that person sleep around, that person does drugs, that person robs, but hey, I ain't did none of that. I'm cool. Well, I'm going to tell you something. Self-righteousness is a sin now. Because we don't know the difference. We don't know that God ain't looking at sins like it is a higher sin, this is a lower sin. No, that's all sin. Amen? Cursing is so interesting. He used to be an addict and had got healed and all this stuff. But one of the things I thought was really awesome he said, he said, hatred is as bad as heroin. Do you understand that? Hatred is as bad as heroin. He said, cursing others out is as bad as cocaine. See, we think slander is not really sin. Slander is. We think like, oh, I can just say whatever. No, 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 no. You can't say whatever you want to say. You need to be careful of how you're speaking. You need to be careful of what you're doing. Yeah, you may not be getting drunk and all this other stuff and doing the most anymore, but you need to recognize that God's standard is really high here, and he wants you to walk it. The Bible says that if there's any appearance of evil in your life, you need to change. Does he give us an opportunity to change? Amen. Is it a possibility? Yes. Why would he put it up there if it wasn't? He says, as well as all types of evil behavior. Instead, be kind. Everybody say kind. To each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as God, through Christ, has forgiven you. Hallelujah. Let's please stand. Thank you. This is what God wants to drive home today. Some of us have been running our mouths, not being careful of how we act. And it's because it's a thought life. There's a mind renewal that needs to take place. There is a pure mind renewal that has to take place. And I'm going to just tell you the truth. This is what the Holy Ghost is telling me. It is time. Please, please listen to me. Guys, from the bottom of my heart. If you have issues with somebody right now, I don't care if somebody from like second grade that kicked the ball in your face. Okay? Like however long it goes back. All right? It's really time to forgive them. It's time to forgive them. It's time to let go of the bitterness. Guys, do you understand that God is trying to give us this clear understanding. Satan wants you to be trapped, not just by your words, but unforgiveness. How we think is extremely important, because how we think ends up what we do and what we say to others. Amen? You could be honest. If you need some help with that, I'm asking you to come up front, okay? If you need some help with that, if you need some strengthening, if you're there sitting down or standing up and you're like, I really feel like I do need to let some people go in my life, let some people go as far as who offended me. This is what Christ said. Christ said, I died to save you from sin and forgave your sins. Now you must forgive others. Amen? And he even takes it to another step and says that if people trespass against you, he said, God in heaven, Father in heaven, will forgive you only if you forgive others. Amen? So it's conditional. So if there is some bitterness, some strife, some anger, you're dealing with some things, you can come up front. If you want to stay where you're at, that's fine. But I'm going to tell you right now, if you want to come up front, we can pray for you. If there is any physical pain that you're going through, or to be real, some emotional pain, you can come up front too. All right? Do you know God is a healer of all things? Amen? 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 Amen. He heals physically and he heals emotionally. Amen. He's healed my body. He's healed my mind. He's healed my heart. I had to go through a whole lot of process. Amen? Let this be the time. Now, if any of you guys have never, you're not born again, or you want to actually give your lives to the Lord, you actually want to make Jesus Christ ahead of your life, here's the thing. Jesus can't just be Savior. He also has to be Lord. Amen? All right? Savior is just like, bail me out. And then you just go back and do the same thing. Lord is like, okay, once you get out, God's like, now follow this. Live like this. I'm going to show you. It's relationship, amen? It's not religion. It is not religion, y'all. This is you making a willful decision to say, Lord, I need you. I want you. I ain't doing anything else anymore. I don't want it no more. I want you. If that's you, come up front. That's what you actually want. If you want that process to go forward. If you need prayer for anything else, you can come up front as well. People of God, can you grab the oil? Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus.